Well, this morning we're going to be in the book of Matthew. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through 38, if you would turn there with me. Matthew chapter 9, 35 through 38. Jesus was going through all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. And seeing the people, he felt compassion for them, because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest." Let's pray. Our great God, we come here this morning, Lord, to worship you, an awesome God who condescended and became flesh, that Christ came and dwelt among us, a sinful people. And it was with great compassion that he came to us, the sick and the lost. And he said, "I'm the great physician. I've come to heal. I've come to bring you into my family." As he breathed his last on that cross, he had our hearts in mind. He had the hearts of his sheep in mind in that moment. And so, Lord, this morning we're going to get a glimpse into this ministry of Christ. And Lord, I just pray that in this time we would have the opportunity to behold more of our sweet Savior, more of his beauty, his majesty, that we would come to understand this love with which he's loved us. And Lord, we can't do that apart from you. We can't do that apart from your Spirit to intercede and to cause us to see and behold him and know him more intimately, more deeply, more fully. So Lord, I'm just asking that you would meet hearts this morning. Quicken those hearts that may not know you, Lord. Let them behold the glorious face of Jesus Christ, in whom all your deity dwelt bodily. We love you, God. We thank you for this time. May you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, for the last 8 weeks, we've been studying Psalm 23 as a church body. And Pastor Ken has taken us through some of the most beautiful glories of being a Christian. We have a good shepherd, and therefore we shall not want. I have everything in Christ, and so what more could I ask for? And we've studied this passage, and we've been so filled with truth, and there's just been this wealth of contentedness among the body, and we just see that. It's been beautiful to witness and to experience that personally as well. I think we were all hit in the face with that question, though, right from the beginning of the psalm. Is he my shepherd? That was the question we were asked from the beginning. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And this is really what it means to be a Christian. When he's your shepherd, when the good shepherd walks beside you and leads you and restores you and guides you and comforts you and prepares a place for you. So as we open this text this morning, we're going to get another glimpse into the faithful work of the good shepherd, Jesus. What marked his ministry? What makes his ministry so different from everything else, from all of the other false religions out there? And what we'll see in this text is that it was compassion that marked his ministry. It was his compassion that drove him to the lost sheep. And it was this compassionate shepherd that has gone before us. And for many of us, he's shown us the way to salvation. It's through him. But what does this now mean for us as believers? We've seen it in his ministry, and we've seen it in our own lives, but what does this mean for us going forward? Does this mean we pull back from the world? We hide out in the church until Christ returns? It can't be. It can't be. That would be to misunderstand the ministry of our shepherd. That would be to miss out on the great calling now upon our lives. And for some, that would be to affirm that we may not know and not have true, genuine compassion. We may not know that from our saving God. As we ponder this beautiful ministry of Christ and we get a glimpse into his heart for the lost, I'm going to ask us here at Southside Bible Church, do you have the same kind of heart for the lost? Do you see the world through the eyes of Christ? I was so convicted as I studied this passage. I feasted on verses 35 and 36, and I tasted of that sweet love, and it was beautiful. And I pray we would all taste of that same love this morning. I pray we would see the compassion of our Savior. And I was fired up. And I was ready to come and throw some punches. And I'm not going to hold anything back, I promise. But there was a problem because there was a log hanging out of my own eye. I'm so convicted by this text. The harvest is indeed plentiful. I've been a coward with the gospel. I don't see the lost with this gospel compassion like I ought. So as I studied this, I was hit between the eyes, and I pray for some of us, we might experience the same. And so we're going to fight for that this morning, because the gospel is to be loved and treasured and enjoyed, but the gospel is also to be shared. It's to be sent out. This is where doctrine meets practice, where truth meets application. We've laid hold of some of the most beautiful truths in Psalm 23, but we've been called to take those truths out now. We're called to go be workers in a plentiful harvest. I firmly believe from my studies this week, a heart that is so deeply in love with Jesus, that knows him as my shepherd, will be driven to the lost. And we will pray to the Lord, God, have mercy. Send out laborers into the harvest. This text deals with the heart of the gospel. What motivates the very condescension of God? Yes, his glory and that beautiful name that is above every other name. But at the core of who God is, we see a God of compassion, a God whose very essence is love. In 1 John, God is love. What does that mean? And this text is going to give us a taste of that love manifested in the gospel, and then it's going to call us to this great calling. How do we respond? Well, the book of Matthew, like the other three gospels, it's unique in its purpose and in its audience. It's written primarily to Jews. So Matthew's chief purpose is to demonstrate that Jesus is the long-awaited Jewish Messiah. And the book of Matthew then it's broken down into five different discourses. And so each discourse is going to deal with a different theme, but it's further substantiating that primary purpose of, again, displaying Jesus as the Messiah. That's what we're getting from this book. And Matthew 9, 35 through 38, our text this morning, it kind of gives us a flavor of two discourses because it falls right in between the first discourse and the second discourse. It's almost a bridge point, this nice transition. The first discourse has been dealing with Christ and the kingdom. What is this kingdom all about? What characterizes this kingdom? We saw that in the Sermon on the Mount, right? And then chapters 8 and 9, it begins to show Jesus himself is the kingdom authority. Some have said chapters 8 and 9 deal with these messianic credentials. What characterizes the king of this kingdom? And then it's going to take us into the second discourse, this text does, and that's dealing primarily with the commissioning of the 12 disciples. It's the sending out. So until this point, the disciples, they've mostly been onlookers. They've observed and they've learned much from Christ's ministry. They've seen his teaching, his preaching, and his healing shared with us in verse 35. And now Jesus is going to begin to involve the disciples firsthand. His ministry's, it's intensifying. This has been my ministry up to this point, and there's been incredible fruit to this point, but now I'm going to delegate this power and open the door for you all to now minister with me. And in verses 36 through 38, rich verses, they allow us to see the motives behind Jesus' ministry as he prepares his disciples to join him in his work. And these very same motives of Jesus are to be our motives and going to the lost. That's the point here. Jesus is commissioning the disciples, but this is our commission too. So I pray that the hearts of believers here at Southside would be joined together as we feel compassion for the lost and are thus driven to them as we're called to do in this text. So our outline this morning, verses 35 through 38 again, our outline this morning, first we're going to look at the ministry of Jesus. Second, we're going to look at the motivation of Jesus. And thirdly, we're going to look at the commission from Jesus. I know what you outline Nazis are already thinking. I'm one of them. You have two M's and then you throw a C at us. What happened to the alliteration? I couldn't think of another M, so I apologize. There's two M's in that word, though, so we'll make up for it. The commission from Jesus. So again, ministry of Jesus, motivation of Jesus, commission from Jesus. So first, verse 35. Let's read it together. Jesus was going through all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. So here we get a glimpse into the ministry of Christ. What has characterized this kingdom ministry up to this point? Well, we're told in the text, teaching, proclaiming the gospel, and healing. This is our ministry. This is the ministry of our humble God. And how easy it is as I was studying this, to sort of just look past such ministry. We've almost become numb to the life of Christ. You ever notice that in your own heart? You ever just ponder the humility involved in this ministry? He's teaching in the synagogues. He's going out on the streets as a town crier. And he's proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom. And he's healing a multitude of diseases and ailments. The God of this universe stooping this low, ministering to us, haters of himself. God in the midst of sinful man. And all of our infirmities and all of our fallenness, God is with us. What kind of God is like our God? Leaving his throne on high where praises ring through his heavenly throne room so as to come and be among us, teaching and proclaiming and healing. Well, I have two contextual observations from the ministry of Jesus that are not necessarily seen in this text, but they're important, again, to this overarching theme of his compassion. Excuse me for a moment. First, Christ reached a lot of people. Oftentimes I read about his ministry and I forget just how many people Christ reached. Thousands and thousands of people reached with the gospel, healed miraculously by Christ. Do you ever just think about the scope of his ministry? One Jewish historian named Josephus, he estimated the scope of Christ's ministry in the region of Galilee. And what he found is that the cities were numerous and they were filled with people. And the smallest of those towns was of at least 15,000 inhabitants. So based on that assessment, Galilee contained at least 3 million people, most of whom had direct contact with Jesus at some point in his ministry. 3 million people, that's a lot of people just in that region of Galilee. Sometimes we forget just how vast Christ's reach really was as he tirelessly walked through the regions teaching, proclaiming, and healing. This was one man, and he was thorough, and he knew his time was limited, and so he reached a multitude of people. We see Christ teaching in the synagogues and proclaiming before giant crowds of people, and they followed him. They followed him. Matthew 4:25 says, large crowds followed him from Galilee and the Decapolis and Jerusalem and Judea and from beyond the Jordan. In Matthew 8, just after the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus came down from the mountain, it says, large crowds followed him. Matthew 8:18, he had such a large crowd around him, he gave orders to depart, to go to the other side of the sea. And you have to think, his ministry was only increasing and the followers were increasing in size. And so just picture this with me. Thousands and thousands of people following Jesus. Thousands of them. As he goes into the synagogues and he's teaching and he's proclaiming to these large crowds and he's healing. And so the second observation I want to make is take notice of one important detail about Christ's ministry. Yes, it was enormous. The magnitude was great. But his ministry was personal. Sometimes we miss this. Take notice of how intentional Christ really was. Focused on the individual he was ministering to. We see this in his teaching in the synagogues and his public proclamation of the gospel. We also see this in his healing. I like what one man named Paul Brand says. Dr. Brand worked among lepers for many years, and he reflects on the way Jesus interacted with the crowds, especially those who were diseased. And listen to what he writes. This is good. Jesus reached out his hand and touched the eyes of the blind, the skin of the person with leprosy, and the legs of the cripple. I've sometimes wondered why Jesus so frequently touched the people he healed, many of whom must have been unattractive, obviously diseased, unsanitary, and smelly. With his power, he easily could have waved a magic wand, but he chose not to. Jesus' mission was not chiefly a crusade against the disease, but rather a ministry to individual people, some of whom happened to have a disease. He wanted those people, one by one, to feel his love and warmth and full identification with them. Jesus knew he could not readily demonstrate love to the crowd, for love usually involves touching. I love this. Jesus touched people to demonstrate his love for them and his individual focus. You want to talk about our God? Look at how the Almighty God of the universe deliberately turns to the person he is healing, and he expresses his compassion as he touches them. I don't want to lose focus of the text, but just observe this with me real quickly. Turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 8. We're just going to see this carried out throughout Christ's ministry. Matthew chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. When Jesus came down from the mountain, large crowds followed him, right after the Sermon on the Mount. And a leper came to him and bowed down before him and said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." And Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, "I am willing, be cleansed." And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Look at Matthew 8, 14 through 15. When Jesus came into Peter's home, he saw his mother-in-law lying sick in bed with a fever. He touched her hand, and that fever left her, and she on him. Matthew 8, 18 through 23. While he was saying these things to them, a synagogue official came and bowed down before him and said, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live." Jesus got up and began to follow him, and so did the disciples. And a woman who had been suffering from a hemorrhage for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she was saying to herself, "If I only touch his garment, I will get well." But Jesus, turning and seeing her, said, "Daughter, take courage. Your faith has made you well." And at once the woman was made well. When Jesus came into the official's house and saw the flute players and the crowd and noisy disorder, he said, "Leave, for the girl has not died, but is asleep." And they began laughing at him. But when the crowd had been sent out, he entered and took her by the hand, and the girl got up. And this news spread throughout all the land. Matthew 8, 27 through 30, our last text to just show this off. As Jesus went out from there, two blind men followed him, crying out, "Have mercy on us, Son of David." When he entered the house, the blind men came up to him, and Jesus said to them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" And they said to him, "Yes, Lord." Then he touched their eyes, saying, "It shall be done to you according to your faith," and their eyes were opened. Do you see the intentionality of our Savior? He knows you by name. He knows your heart. This describes the heart of a good shepherd, as we've been studying over the last 8 weeks. Searching out that one sheep that has gone astray, rejoicing when he returns, one by one, the God of this universe, turning, seeing, caring for people, smelly, rotten, sin-saturated people. What love and compassion. This is our God. And this is what it is to look like for us. Taking the time to address someone. How easy it is in our fast-paced culture to just get lost in the busyness. What would it look like if we just took the time to turn and to focus our attention on someone? to listen and to hear them out, just to listen to their struggles and their needs, and then opening our mouth with the glorious remedy for their souls, which is the gospel of the kingdom. This means meeting someone at Starbucks or at Pizza Hut, wherever it would be, and sitting with them and hearing them so that then you can give them the greatest gift ever offered to man. The gospel is personal because it involves a Savior who is personal. A missionary by the name of George Mueller. Shortly after George Mueller was responsible for starting, I don't even know how many orphanages, a lot, thousands of orphans that he had direct contact with in Bristol, England. When he first got to Bristol, England, the city was devastated by an epidemic of cholera, which at the time was highly contagious, especially by touch. It was known of George Mueller that he would go out on the streets. I mean, thousands of people were dying in the streets. He would go out on the streets against his wife's will. He would go out on the streets and he would reach out to these lowly. He would find the kids in the alleys and he would hold them in his arms as he gave them the gospel as they died and they breathed their last. This was a man who knew the Good Shepherd. He knew the Good Shepherd. He was willing to lay it all out to go and to serve him. This is what is so beautiful about the Christian faith. God himself among sinful man. No other religion can claim such a thing. I just pray we'd be captured by the beauty of the gospel. It's captured my heart, especially in this study. Second point, the motives of Jesus. The motives of Jesus. What drives Jesus to you and me, to the lost sheep? What drives us? What drives him to us? He saw beyond the physical needs straight to the heart. You see, compassion has nothing to do with you and me and everything to do with God. This is his characteristic. This is his nature, his very essence to care for, love for, and suffer for. Look at Deuteronomy 7:7-8. You don't have to turn there. I'll read it for you. The Lord did not set his love on you nor choose you. This is Israel he's speaking to. Because you are more in number than any of the peoples. For you are the fewest of all peoples. But because the Lord loved you, there's our explanation, and kept the oath which he swore to your forefathers. We live in a rationalistic society. We're always looking for answers in this text. Because the Lord loved you, and he kept his oath which he swore to your forefathers. It's all about God and his covenant-keeping love from the beginning. It's his very nature. He felt compassion for them. Just picture this with me in our text. Christ looking out among the crowds, all of those who've been following him for months, they were always there with him, thousands and thousands of them. And they never heard someone speak with so much authority and perform such incredible miracles. And many came with specific needs, and they were often physical. And yet the king of this universe, he pauses from his outward ministry. And he saw with a divine eye, and he saw an infinitely greater need in their eyes and in their lives. He saw the desperate state of their souls. He saw the depth of their sin, their discontented spirits. He saw with compassion the deepest of all needs among mankind, the need for salvation. The need for forgiveness, for Christ-like righteousness, for life. He saw those needs. The Greek word that's used here in our text for compassion, it involves the bowels, the guts. It's the deepest sense of longing and affection. It's a midsection type of love. We see Paul use the same expression at times. John MacArthur says it well. He says this, Christ felt in his own body the symptoms of his deep caring. If our bodies literally ache in pain and nausea when we experience great agony, remorse, or sympathy, we can be sure that the Son of Man felt them even more. Have you ever felt this same sort of aching, agonizing pain? You have such a compassion for someone or something. I'm a parent now, so I get to use parent illustrations. Some of you are like, ha, you don't have that right until you have a teenager. And that's true. I praise God, I got 13 years of maturity before we have a teenager. He's gracious like that. As they mature, we also mature, I hope. But as I was in the, Jackie and I were in the delivery room. We'd just given birth to Hudson. And they're like 20 different nurses coming in your room, right? They're like, get lots of rest. And they just keep coming, like every 10 minutes. They just keep coming in. And then the nurse walks in with the tray, and she has the shots, and she's ready to give your baby the shots. And right then and there, you start watching as they're poking and they're grabbing at your baby, and he's screaming, and all you can do is just watch as they torture your child. I have a fear of shots too, so it's slightly amplified for me. But really, you hurt for them. You feel the pain of what's happening. Perhaps you've been there. You long for them. It's terrible, but that's just a small taste of what our Savior experienced for us as he looked out on us with compassion. It was that deep, longing compassion. There's just no way to get around it. It's a midsection type of love. It's his guts, his very guts, that he has that kind of compassion for us. God is a holy God, thrice holy in fact. He's a righteous judge who cannot let sin dwell in his presence. Get that? It must be paid for in order for us to even stand in his holy presence. But if we end there, then we miss the gospel. We need that. But if we end there, we miss something great. God is holy and righteous, but God is the God of love. Christ, as he suffered upon that tree, looked at you and me and said, I'm dying for you because I love you. He set his love upon us, and he did what no man can do for us. He took our place. That we would not miss this when we think about the gospel, when we go and we preach the gospel to others. God is a personal God. And he took a crown of thorns on your behalf if you would believe on the gospel. Why would we look anywhere else for love? What a fallacy. Where else should we go? You're loved in Christ. Let the love of the gospel just saturate your heart. If you're here and you don't know this love of Christ, let that love saturate your heart. You're loved in Christ if you believe in him. There's a song called The Look. I think it was put out by Sovereign Grace. And it says, forever etched upon my mind is the look of him who died, the Lamb I crucified. And now my life will sing the praise of pure atoning grace that looked on me and gladly took my place. That is the gospel. And time would fail us to describe this compassion that he has had on some of our lives. I mean, testimony after testimony of hearts proclaiming his loving kindness is greater than life. I know so many here that would testify to that. Let's keep going in our text. He felt compassion because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd. The image we have here in Matthew 9, it's a bleak one, and it should stir our hearts. Jesus turns and he sees us, and it grieves his heart what he sees. He says, we are distressed and dispirited. This is our condition apart from Christ. And you see, Jesus didn't just see their sighs. He didn't just see their sin, but he saw the depth of their suffering, which was a result of their sin. And distressed is a weighty word in the Greek. Its root meaning is that of flaying or skinning. It can mean harass. Some of your translations probably say it. And it often connotes the idea of being battered, mangled, ripped apart, worn out, and exhausted. Does it get more graphic than that? Jesus saw the crowd, and he saw them as devastated people by their inward condition. Dispirited is the other word used in this translation. It can also be read as downcast. We've studied that well in the 23rd Psalm. It has the meaning of being thrown down and helpless. This is our condition apart from Christ. This is how Christ saw them. This is how Christ saw you and me. I went on a backpacking trip about 3 years ago, and we were up in the Maroon Bells. And we're trying to beat out this storm, and I had this opportunity to just pause and look out. And sure enough, right in that moment, there were hundreds of sheep coming over this mountain, and it was quite a spectacle. I have pictures of it. And as I'm watching them go over the mountain, one by one, these sheep would literally lose their stepping, their lose their foothold, and they would stumble down this mountain, and then they'd get back on their feet, and they'd keep going. And it was a crazy sight. I don't know how else to explain it. But in that moment, it was almost as if I was seeing, like Christ saw in that moment. That's our condition. That's how he sees us, sheep without a shepherd. The scribes and the Pharisees were said to be their leaders. They were said to be the leaders. And yet they knew nothing of green pastures and quiet waters. Jesus knew that. He's looking out and he's saying, you're sheep without a shepherd. You don't have a true shepherd. They knew nothing of true love and care. Their religion was one of burdens and self-righteous traditions. In Ezekiel 35, we see God rebuking these false shepherds through his prophet Ezekiel. Listen to what he says. He says, woe, shepherds of Israel, who've been feeding themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flock? Behold, I am against the shepherds, and I will demand my sheep from them and make them cease from feeding sheep. I will deliver my flock. Behold, I myself will search for my sheep and seek them out. Listen to that language, and now look at the context here. This great deliverer is upon us. His name is Jesus, and he's come to seek out the lost sheep. The good shepherd is here. Praise God. In the same way the Pharisees distorted the message of salvation then, so it has been distorted today, so much so. The free gift of grace offered to us in Christ has been cheapened by man's work and man's deeds. You have to earn your way to God. And that question, have you done enough? The question that every other religion asks you. And you can almost hear the cry of our Savior. Come, come unto me, all ye who are burdened and heavy laden, and I shall give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I am the shepherd who has come to seek out the lost sheep and bring them back into my fold. How refreshing. The good shepherd is here upon us. Does this beautiful truth of the gospel, this saving love of God, do anything in your heart? I'd ask myself that question. Do you see the lost through this same lens that Christ saw the lost? This brings us to our third point and our final point, the commission from Jesus. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. The harvest represents the multitudes and the impending judgment that awaits everyone apart from Christ. Everyone will one day stand before God, and to many he will say, I never knew you intimately, relationally. I wasn't your shepherd. It's one of the saddest burdens that we have as Christians. Some of our loved ones will hear that from our God. But if you know him, Romans 10 had better be a reality in your life, Jesus is saying. Romans 10, 14 through 15. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? How will they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Do you see the need, Christian? The world needs him. They need him. We have the very remedy to their souls, the gospel of the kingdom, and it's found within jars of clay that their surpassing greatness belongs to God alone. They need Jesus. Are we willing to go? We have to ask ourselves this question this morning. Are we willing to herald this message, to hold the banner high and shout his name from the mountaintops? Are we willing? Are we willing to go to the difficult places, the Muslim-populated places, where ISIS proudly holds Christian heads, one in each hand as they mock the God we love? Are we willing to go to those places? Are we willing to go to the 16th Street malls and press on, even as we're met with jeers and scoffs? Are we willing to enter university campuses and, and shatter the blatant apathy of university life? Are we willing to go and knock on our neighbor's doors and invite them over for a meal to teach them the truth about Christ? Are we willing to go to our grandparents and aunts and uncles and cousins at family reunions to plead for their souls? The only way we will possibly go is if we see Christ in this text loving us with a deep, longing compassion. We love because he first loved us. A compassion that says, I see you in your broken and lost state, and I want nothing more but for you to be in my family. He's bought us into his family. We are sons and daughters of the living God. What do we have to fear? See the world with eyes like Jesus. Plead for God to give you a compassion and love for them. I'm guilty of, stop sneering at them from behind the curtains in your family room or kitchen. Oh, this wicked generation, they're just too set in their ways. I'll never get through to that person. We've got to stop buying that lie and start living like Christ. He's gone before us. And John 10 tells us his sheep will hear his voice. What do we have to fear? What do we have to fear? We preach about a kingdom that is upon us, Christ in us. And if Christ has taken up residence in your heart, you will obey his voice. That's what your new heart longs to do. So is Christ in you? Is Christ in you? Is he your shepherd? Do you remember in John chapter 4, we read about the woman at the well? When Jesus is speaking with the woman at the well, what happens after? It says the woman leaves her water pot behind and she goes to the city, right? And she tells all the men, is this the Christ? And they come after him. And then the disciples join up with Christ. And they say, Rabbi, eat. And Jesus replies, I have food to eat that you do not know about. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Do you not say there are yet 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white for harvest. So where is the harvest? It's right before us. And we are called to go engage it. We're called to go engage this world with the gospel. He has prepared the harvest, and now he's calling us to go and be his hands and feet. Some of us just need to lift up our eyes and look out on the fields, for they're white. Jesus is telling you right here, the harvest is plentiful. Go. And as you go out to the nations, you will be full because you're doing the will of the Father. My satisfaction is tied to doing the Father's will. Are you full this morning? The harvest is plentiful. Go and feast, Christ is telling us. See them with a Christ-like compassion. See this world for who they are. See them as Christ saw you. He had compassion for you. Do you love him? Those forgiven much love much. I don't care what man thinks any longer. I don't care how I'm viewed in schools or at the workplace. I pray this for myself. All I care about is serving God who loves me unconditionally and forever. That's all I care about. That has to be our hearts. And I pray that for my own heart and for yours. That all we care about is hearing these words, well done, my good and faithful servant. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter the joy of your master. Verse 38, as we get to our final verse and close out. Therefore, beseech the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest. Beseech, it's to pray, to pray. This is the kind of praying that is joining with God and his heart as we beg him to be merciful and to send out workers into his harvest. It's participating with his will. I long for your name to go out, Father. That's the cry of our souls. So we have two final observations from this last call to us. This is Jesus calling the disciples, ready to commission them. Pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest. Notice where we go first. Where do we go first? We go to the Lord first. Compassion cannot be manufactured. It cannot be produced apart from the supernatural working of God. John Piper says, prayer is the open admission that apart from Christ, we can do nothing. This is what it means then to wait on the Lord. We're called to wait on the Lord. It means seeking him with diligence, to beseech him, to beg him, to implore him. It doesn't mean sitting back and twiddling your thumbs, although I like to believe that sometimes. It means earnestly seeking him in the quiet place. Fervent prayer. I will not let go of thee until thee bless me. I want this compassion. There's urgency. We need the supernatural working of God. We're called to go to him first and foremost. Our second observation. Notice what Jesus tells us to pray for. He doesn't tell us to pray for the lost in this context, though we know that to be important from other texts. He tells us to pray for laborers. This makes a distant prayer personal. It's not just, oh Lord, move in that person's heart, but rather it's, Lord, mobilize people that can speak into that person's life with the gospel. Put someone there to preach it to them that they may hear and be saved. Do you hear the difference there? And more often than not, as we pray these prayers, it will be God pressing on our hearts, it is you I am calling. And we'll see that eventually in Matthew chapter 10 when the disciples are sent out. They're called to do this, and now it's you I'm calling. And they're sent out. Pray that you may be moved to action. Southside Bible Church, we have got to die to ourselves to live for Christ. Jesus made it clear in his final command to the disciples here in Matthew. His final call to the believers, to the disciples and to us believers was not study your doctrine. It was not have community groups. It was not start book studies and have good church fellowship. It was not keep your kids busy with good church activity. Although, please hear me, those things are important. I'm not throwing those off. But could it be that we have missed it? Could it be that we have missed it? That we just fill ourselves with so many of these church activities and good programs and good teaching, but we miss the heart of what we have ultimately been called to do? Struck my heart so much. I'm convinced that so many of our internal issues, I'm just so empty right now. I'm dry. My walk with the Lord is so stagnant. That those issues could be solved by a willingness to go out to the lost. To go do the will of the Father. He promises us this will fill you up. That's the promise of our good shepherd. Good news will grow stagnant when it just sits there. It's meant to be shared. Go and serve someone other than yourself, and what blessing you will find. It's promised to us by our loving Savior. What is Jesus' final call here in Matthew? We've been moving toward it through his whole ministry. Matthew 28, 19 through 20. And we'll close with this. Let this just permeate your own heart. Maybe you're this saint who's here, who's been praying for the lost, and now perhaps you see that's me he's calling. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded of you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Let's pray. God, your love is so deep. It is so vast. It's incomprehensible apart from your Spirit working in our hearts. So, Lord, I'm just praying that today as we go from here, Lord, we would just get just that glimpse of your love for us, that glimpse of that deep compassion that you have for us. Lord, those words of Jesus, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were unwilling. God, this is the deep affection and compassion of our Savior. Let no heart be hardened this morning as they leave from this place, Lord. Let us openly receive your love, this free gift that's been offered to us in Christ. We're pleading, Lord, for your Spirit to meet us. And in so doing, Lord, would we see your infinite worth, your absolute beauty and glory, which is on display for us in your Son, Jesus, the name that is above every other name. And Lord, as we behold that glory, would we say, you are worthy to go into the harvest and to reap the harvest. Lord, move in hearts this morning to not just hear a message, to put it in their back pocket for more knowledge down the road, but Lord, let us be those that would be called to action, to go and to share this good news, because good news grows stagnant if it just sits there. Lord, please move in hearts. Father, would people be led only by you? Lord, I am just a fumbling voice up here. Father, you are the one that moves in hearts, so I'm just pleading for your Spirit to meet hearts this morning. We're dependent on you completely. And God, we do. We love you. And we praise you for this time, for your word. We praise you for your Son, Jesus. We give him all the glory in Jesus' name.